This is Marie Louise's actual diary. I set out for Compiègne, delighted with the idea of such a pleasant journey. I had never before traveled without sadness, but now felt the undertaking would be delightful and am certain I shall love traveling to distraction. The Queen of Naples and the Grand Duke of Würzburg accompanied us. It was a particular pleasure to have the latter with me. He is so kind and vivacious. We left Compiègne on April 27th at 9 in the morning. The country, as far as St. Quentin, is very pretty, even beautiful, also very fertile. All along the road are little hills covered with fruit trees, now in full bloom, and fields of the most fascinating green, intersected by small streams bordered with willows. There are many hamlets and villages, but what struck me most was the quantity of windmills. In every place, the emperor was received by the inhabitants with ringing of bells and firing of salutes, expressions of a devotion as simple as it was touching. Everywhere, the young ladies presented us with flowers and poems. Most of the latter were very poor. We arrived at St. Quentin at midday and were lodged in the prefecture, where everything was uncomfortable and dirty. And what was worse was the fact that I was a quarter of a league away from the emperor. He took luncheon at once and rode off to visit the fortifications and the source of the St. Quentin Canal, which had been just finished from a plan provided by the emperor himself. I went to bed with lumbago, not yet being accustomed to continuous traveling over paved roads. The emperor made me get up at 4 o'clock to visit a cotton mill belonging to the prefect, which is remarkable. The machines are wonderful inventions. On our return, we received the chief officials. The emperor conversed with them for over 2 hours. These audiences are enough to kill one, for it is necessary to stand all the time. Afterwards, young ladies presented me with specimens from their factories. The emperor was much amused while telling me of an accident which happened to Monsieur Jean, who, while galloping without looking where he was going, was caught on the branch of a tree. The horse went on, and after a few minutes, he fell to the ground without hurting himself in the least. Malicious tongues say that for more than an hour, he thought himself dead, which is very like him. After dinner, there was a ball at the town hall, and a cantata was sung, which contained the most fulsome compliments. The queen opened the ball by dancing a contra dance française with Chamberlain de Metternich. The town of St. Quentin has about 12,000 inhabitants. It is very old and badly built, but commercially flourishing. The local manufacturers are long cloth, linen, cambric, leather, and morocco. The trade in cotton brings in over 3 million annually. Next day, we left St. Quentin at 7 in the morning, and after passing through the whole of the city, which is not very large, we arrived at the canal, where we found two gondolas awaiting us. The canal begins in St. Quentin and terminates at Cambrai, where it joins the Scheldt. It is over 22 lengths in length, having 23 locks, and is very wide and deep. We went on board and continued our way beneath a blazing sun, which gave us terrible headaches. We reached the first tunnel, into which the water had not yet been admitted, and entered carriages in order to pass through it. The length is a quarter of a league, entirely cut out of rock. The vault is very high and was illuminated by two rows of lamps, which made a magnificent effect. It is a masterpiece, unique of its kind. We continued our journey by carriage as far as the entrance to the second tunnel, where tents had been pitched for lunch, which we welcomed like famished travelers. We went through this tunnel, which is a league and a half long, in a boat rowed by men, which was not very serviceable, but it let in 2 inches of water, which wetted our feet. But as there was no means of remedying it, one had to bear up gaily, which for me was not difficult, as I have an iron constitution, which nothing injures. In addition, we narrowly escaped capsizing because of the fat Prince Schwarzenberg was continually leaning out of the boat, and his weight threw it all on one side. The second tunnel was illuminated like the first, and at the end of every 100 toises, about 650 feet, there was a shaft to let in daylight. After an hour and a half, we reached the mouth of the canal and got into the carriages again. We saw the source of the Scheldt, that majestic river, which 40 leagues farther on is so wide and deep that the largest battleships can navigate it, but it is here so narrow that one can easily cross it by a standing jump. It passes twice under the canal, which is carried over it by means of an aqueduct. The bridge is so narrow that we were obliged to leave the carriages, which were then lifted over by men. This affair delayed us more than an hour, put the Queen of Naples in such a bad temper that no one could speak to her for the rest of the day. I cannot understand how people when traveling can grumble and get patient over such trifling accidents. To me, they were very insignificant in comparison with all I had to put up with in other journeys, of which I had never complained.